सत्यं परं धीमहि, ओम सत्यं परं धीमहि, ओम सत्यं परं धीमहि, ओम सत्यं परं धीमहि, ओम सत्यं परं धीमहि।
Please breathe with the music. Close your eyes. Feel the breath moving in and out with the music, with the rhythm. The breath merges with the blood and moves throughout the body. Try to hold this sensation of the breath. Swas loi sathe bhari ne akha sharir ma phare chhe eni samvedna le. We'll relax the body. Use our attention to relax the body. Relax the head. Take your attention to the head, relax the head. Breathe with the music. The forehead, the two eyes and around the eyes, banne aankh, the nose, two ears, the two cheeks. There's a lot of tension in the cheeks. Relax the cheeks. The two lips, inside the mouth, tongue, gums, teeth, the chin, dadi, chin, loosen the jawbone, jagbu dhim chorega, loosen the jawbone, relax the neck, the two shoulders. There's a lot of tension in the shoulders. Relax the shoulders. The two hands. The back. The chest. Stomach. Two legs. The whole body is in deep relaxation, as if the body is empty, just the breath is moving in and out. Now that empty space, fill it up with your presence. Je khali jagya chhe ne apna hova pada thi bhari le. Fill it up with your presence. Feel the heaviness of your presence, as if you have come, I have come, I am here. And when I am here, there are no tensions, there are no worries, there is no past or future, just I am. Hold the feeling of your presence. The breath is in the present moment, but our presence is in eternity. Try to feel these two different feelings, breath and presence. Swas vartman shanma chhe, hova paro shashvatta chhe. Bane ne ek sathe pakadvani koshish karo. Hold both the feelings, presence and present. Slowly the music will stop. Continue holding the two feelings. We'll be together for the next 1 hour and 15 minutes. Try to hold your presence, I am, throughout the session. In ancient Greece, there was a great teacher. His name was Heraclitus. And Heraclitus had one famous saying: you cannot step in the same river twice. Once the water has flown ahead, it's gone. So he would talk of something called presence, the exercise we are doing, to hold the presence. If you think the water has already gone, you're already in the past. Thought is always in the past. Thought can never be in the present moment. We can never experience life through thought. The minute we see something beautiful and we say, oh, it is so beautiful, the water has passed. It's gone. We've not experienced it. But that which we are seeing, if it is a flower, or if it is a sunset, or it could be a work of art, it has a presence. And instead of thinking, if we can hold our presence, just be present in the present, to hold our presence in the present, then our presence and the presence of that flower merges. And without thought, we experience life. This is a divine experience. It is worth working for. Even if it can happen even once in our life, to experience life free of thought. So today we go ahead in our path of self-observation, and when we take our attention inside, the first thing we will try to observe is our inner chatter. The monkey is chattering all the time, and it is different eyes within us which are chattering. And why it is the first step is because if we cannot observe within ourselves, at least we can start by observing our outer chatter. How much of energy, how much of force we waste in unnecessary talking. Outer chatter. We can start from there and try to move in. So the first group of eyes we will talk about are the ones which love to chatter all the time. Our deepest problem, which we never see throughout our lives, is that even though we look wide awake, we live in a deep sleep. આપણને એવું લાગે છે કે આપણે જાગતા છીએ, હકીકતે ગહેરી ઊંઘમાં જીવન નીકળી જાય છે, પસાર થઈ જાય છે હાજરી વગર. Even as we are talking, we are dreaming 1001 thoughts. It's going on, the chatter goes on. It doesn't stop. It is thinking every word which is being said, instead of being present, just to hold the presence. So, we look wide awake, but the deep sleep continues within us all the time. Now, supposing we start, or maybe we have a business which has been going on for some time, and we say we want to improve the business. So, we say the first thing we will do is that we will stop wastages. If there's a wastage of money or wastage of manners or wastage of energy, jyan leakage che aapke business so aapna dhanda ne agar vadharu che to jyan jyan leakage of money and energy jyan che we will stop that. Similarly, when we walk on the inner path, the first step is to stop the leakages of energy. Where are we losing force throughout the day? And two places we will see. One is the inner chatter, the buck which goes on all the time. And the other is imagination. And like we've already seen, it is a little difficult to observe imagination. So we cannot initially work with imagination. જ્યારે લીકેજ બંધ કરવાની વાત આવે છે ત્યારે બે જગ્યાએ લીકેજ સતત ચાલુ છે. એક જે અંદર બકબક ચાલુ છે અને આપણે શક્તિ ગુમાવીએ છીએ, અને બીજું જે આપણે કલ્પનાઓમાં ઉડ્યા કરતા હોય છે, પણ કલ્પનાઓ સાથે આપણે એક તરત કામ ન કરી શકીએ. પણ ઇમિડિયેટ જે ફર્સ્ટ સ્ટેપ છે, પહેલું પગલું છે, અંદરના બક બક સાથે કામ કરવું. એવરી સાયકિક એક્ટ ટેક્સ ફોર્સ. અંદર વિચાર ઉત્પન્ન થાય, અંદર ભાવ ઉત્પન્ન થાય, અંદર તરંગ ઉત્પન્ન થાય, આપણી શક્તિ એની સાથે જાય જ છે. સો વેધર ઇટ ઇઝ અ થોટ, વેધર ઇટ ઇઝ અ ફીલિંગ, whether it is some kind of aggressiveness, every psychic act takes its packet of energy, takes its packet of force. Nothing can happen within us without force, without energy. If I am jealous of someone, if something is irritating me, and if my chain of thoughts is following that jealousy, if it is following the cause of that irritation, the perceptible cause, which is never the real cause, but the perceptible cause, then every moment that this chain of thoughts continue, every moment that I'm burning in jealousy, I'm losing energy. And it is this energy that I want to walk on the inner path. જો મને ઈર્ષા આવતી હોય, જો મને અંદરથી ઇરિટેશન આવતું હોય, અને એની સાથે મારા વિચારોની શૃંખલા જો ચાલુ હોય, તો હર ક્ષણે હું શક્તિ ગુમાવી રહ્યો છું. અને આ જ શક્તિની જરૂર છે અંદર જવા માટે. હવે this study of force, this study of energy, I'm using the word force because energy is matter, but force will imply consciousness. It is the same thing, so, but it is a little complicated. When we act consciously, when we are in a state of divided attention, then every psychic act gains force, it does not lose force. Now, can we just meditate a little upon this? આપણે જો અંદર જાગૃતિમાં હોય, આપણે જો આપણું પ્રેઝન્સ હોય, તો હરેક જે સાયકિક એક્ટ અંદર ચાલે છે એ કોન્શિયસલી જો ચાલે તો આપણને શક્તિ મળે છે, ગુમાવતા નથી. કેન વી થિંક અબાઉટ ધીસ? મેન હેઝ અ વેરી વેરી પ્રેશિયસ એનર્જી. નો અધર form of life has that energy. Let us call this energy as psychic energy. Har ek manushya paase ek unique, ek adbhut shakti hoy chhe je bija koi pan prani ma hotu nathi. Now this energy comes as a result of a certain act which happens in sleep. Just as the source of all energy is from the sun, all nature's energy comes from the sun. Man has one unique energy which does not come from the sun. Is Surya Mati Nathiya? When he goes to sleep at night, the soul which is a part, which is sitting behind the psychic structure, the psychic structure sort of suspends itself, all the centers stop being active, the different eyes inside stop being active, and the soul goes back into the spirit in deep sleep. That is why they say if you can go into the state of deep sleep consciously, you are in samadhi. જ્યારે મનુષ્ય રાતે સૂઈ જાય છે ત્યારે જીવ અંદરના આત્માને મળવા જાય છે. So the soul goes to meet the spirit, it bathes in the spirit and it comes out as we come out of deep sleep, and this happens 2-3 times in the night. This is not something which science can verify. There's no way science can measure a soul. But if we can take our consciousness into deep sleep, we will be a witness to this happening. So it comes back with a certain energy, and because this energy is not available anywhere else in life, the rest of life wants to take this energy from man. Nature wants to take this energy from man. She needs this energy. Man for her is just a machine to produce this energy. She cannot get it from anywhere else. She needs man to give her this energy so she can take this energy and use it in certain areas of the universe. And that is why nature is eyeing this energy. A shakti upar prakruti ni najar chhe. રાતે જે આપણે લઈને સવારે આવીએ છીએ. એન્ડ નેચર, ધી ઓનલી વે શી કેન સ્ટીલ ધીસ એનર્જી ફ્રોમ મેન ઇઝ ઇફ હી લૂઝિસ કોન્શિયસનેસ. નાઉ ધીસ ઇઝ ધ ગેમ ઓફ ચેસ. ધીસ ગેમ ઓફ લાઈફ ઇઝ ધીસ ગેમ ઓફ ચેસ બિટવીન ઈચ ઇન્ડિવિજ્યુઅલ એન્ડ નેચર. નેચર થ્રોઝ ધ નેટ, નેચર થ્રોઝ ધ હિપ્નોસિસ, nature rolls the dice, like in the Mahabharata, the game of dice, and Yudhishthira is hypnotized and we are hypnotized. Nature throws the dice and she'll throw something to upset us. Maybe she'll say, okay, your wife has had an accident or something, suddenly we are upset, we've lost our consciousness, we are hypnotized by the event. And now the inner chattering has started. What has happened? The worrying eyes have come up on the surface and they've started talking to each other. and we are losing energy, and we are losing this precious energy which we gained at night in sleep, and she's taking this energy from us. It could be anything. The husband may just say, okay, what is this tea you've made? It's very cold. And we are irritated. And nature takes the energy. Or we may come out and we see a bird has spoiled the window of our car and we get irritated. Nature has taken the energy. And sometimes it gathers up. And I'm leaving my home and there's a small stone in the pathway. I feel a little irritated and I hold it on. And then I go to the car and the lock doesn't open. And again I feel a little irritated and it holds on. And then I'm in traffic. And the traffic is moving very slowly. Again I'm a little irritated. And it gathers up. And then the inner battery is charged throughout the day. And by evening I come home and my wife and it explodes. So, everything in life happens without consciousness. Now, at that moment when nature throws the net, when she throws the stone, jare prakruti kakro feke che, ane the irritation is starting to rise and we separate from the irritation, we watch it and we don't allow her to take this very precious energy which we have gained through the night, then she has to give up some of her energy to us. Either she wins or we win. And if we win, there is a rising in consciousness and we gain some energy from nature, very precious energy from nature. This is all that spirituality is about. Either she takes it or we take it. If we take it, we rise in consciousness. This is all it is about. We can understand this. So, to understand what is force, what is psychic energy is a little complicated. But we must also understand the scale of things. There is a big conspiracy to steal this energy from us. And it is on the scale of nature. That is a very big scale. Now when we are trying to save this energy and awaken to life, we are working on our small miniature scale, individual scale. But the conspiracy to steal this energy from us is on a larger scale. That is why sadhana is so difficult. It is so difficult to hold the presence. Because on a larger scale, there is a conspiracy that we don't hold it. Jagruti aghru che. Apnu hovapana ne pakadvu aghru che. Aghru etle che. Karan ke apne je mehnat kariye che, apna vyaktigat scale upar mehnat kariye che. Ane je prapanch che, e prakruti na scale upar prapanch che. Ke prakruti ne ashakti apni paase thi chhinvi levi che. So just see, I'm jealous, I'm upset, I'm irritated, and can you see the inner mumbling which goes on, the inner chattering which goes on, and how this is pulling me down? I'm losing energy, I'm losing force. But if in that state I'm in a state of double arrowed attention, then I won't lose force. So the first step is to stop the leakages of energy. And the first leakage is our inner chattering. So, remember this, every thought, every emotion which happens without our consciousness takes our energy. You've lost it. This is a total waste of force with no result in our lives. So, we start observing this inner chattering. and we start observing our outer chatting. Where are we talking unnecessary? Now, as we observe the inner talking, we will see that it is a breeding ground. This whole psychic structure of ours, this inner talking, is a breeding ground for unpleasant moods, unpleasant states, for negative states. The minute I am irritated about something and my whole state is negative, and as I start chattering inside, I'm feeding the fire and that negativity increases. I'm going deeper and deeper into this negative hypnotic state. Now, if we can observe properly, slowly we will come to certain conclusions that where this what is the root of this inner talking? What is the root of this inner talking? And how do we stop this inner talking? In the Mahabharata, there is one asur, one demon called Bakasur. And Bakasur means buck, chattering, buck, Bakasur. Buck means a crane, chattering all the time. And he likes to eat humans. Manas ne khai jaye. Can you see how that inner, demon called Bakasur, that monkey chattering all the time, is eating human flesh and blood, psychic flesh and blood. Is eating it all the time. And Bhim goes to kill him. The Pandavas are staying in one Brahman's house and the Brahman's wife is crying, and Kunti goes to ask, why are you crying? He says, today is my daughter's turn. We have to give it to this demon for him to eat. It's his meal. So Kunti says, don't worry, my son will go in her place. And the whole town people have gathered a whole cart of food to give to this demon, this asur. And Bhim takes that food, but instead of giving it to the demon, before he meets it, he eats it all himself. You see, when we want to kill that inner talking, first we have to stop giving it petrol. Stop giving it food. We have to cut off its supplies. And then that Rakshas, that demon, comes out of the cave and he fights with him and he breaks his backbone and kills him. This inner talking, you have to break the backbone. Please do simple exercises in life. Don't sit for hours in meditation. Just do simple exercises. Say in the morning you are in a hurry to go to office. Make a resolution that when I take the keys of my car in my hand from my home, and till I reach the car, no inner talking. No inner talking. And if you've gone out of your house, and on the pathway you see one pot has fallen like this and the monkey starts chattering, go back home. Start again. Punish yourself. Punish yourself. See, you don't have to do big things. You have to just have an intensity of practice. There must be a continuity of practice. Just practice in small things. Suddenly you feel the urge for a cup of tea. Right. And this, you're asking for tea from inside, and then say, okay, not now, after 10 minutes. After 10 minutes. Now, this is the best meditation you can do. Just say after 10 minutes. But if you interrupt, then you won't get it for half an hour. Try to See how, bring some inner will to work with this inner chatter. Bring some inner will. At times we feel we are in a state of just of getting into irritation. Maybe we have worked the whole day and the clothes are sticking to the body and we are full of sweat and tired and we just want to take it out and go into the bath. Pause again. And just say, okay, I'll have the bath, but after 15-20 minutes. Right? And just observe inside how this inner demon called Bakasur and all his helpers and all, they come out and they start chattering. And over a period of time, we will be able to work with this inner chatter. This is a great step, very big step we have taken. When Patanjali talks about samadhis, later on we will go when he talks about samadhis. I don't think we'll reach samadhi this year, but when he talks about samadhis, the first samadhis he talks about, vitarka, vichara, ananda, asmita. Some people add one more over there, rupa, some don't add. In some readings of Patanjali, the word rupa is not there. We will add it. Vitarka, vichara, ananda, asmita, rupa, anugamata, sampragnata. He says that the first samadhis are of four or five kinds. They are samadhi with knowledge. They are the lowest form of samadhi. The first he calls vitarka. This is the uppermost layer of the what river we call mind. It is the ripples on the top, and the mind is not calm. It is chattering all the time. And he says, when this chatter calms down, that is the first samadhi. My teacher, Tavariya Sai, has called this the samadhi with judicial reasoning. And he says that great statesmen, great thinkers, at a certain point in their thinking, they reach a point where thought stops for some time and something from the higher descends in that empty space and they are able to make a right decision. Sharvatma Patanjali paanch samadhi ni vaat kare chhe. Vitark, vichar, ananda, asmita, rupa. A paanch samadhi. He kye chhe ke a sharvat ni samadhi. Ema sauthi pehlu જે એ વાત કરે છે વિતર્ક સંપ્રજ્ઞા સમાધિ. પ્રજ્ઞા એટલે નોલેજ, વિથ નોલેજ, ધ સમાધિ વિથ નોલેજ. એન્ડ વી સી મેની પીપલ ઇન લાઈફ ગેટ ધીસ સમાધિ, બટ ટુ મેક ઇટ પરમનન્ટ ધીસ મંકી મસ્ટ સ્ટોપ ચેટરિંગ. વિતર્ક, તર્ક, વિતર્ક, ઇટ કીપ્સ ઓન ચેટરિંગ ઇનસાઇડ, રાઈટ? સો ધેટ It's a very big step we have taken. It is the first experience of samadhi we will have. The first experience of higher consciousness. With knowledge, does not matter. But it's the beginning of inner transformation. So, as we observe, we get to know where this inner talking is coming from. What is the source of this? Now, we have a tongue, outer tongue, we have an inner tongue. Only we can't see it in the mirror. But we have an inner tongue. And if my tooth is moving, or if I have an ulcer in the mouth, or if I bit my lip by mistake, then my tongue keeps on going there. Right? So, wherever my mouth is sore, my tongue keeps on going there. Similarly, where does my inner tongue go? Where does my inner tongue go? You have insulted me yesterday, now my inner tongue will keep on going there. And the minute it goes there and the wound is fresh, and the chattering starts. And how many psychological wounds do we have? The same sutra. My teacher is saying, yoga is calming of the thinking instrument, calming the chattering, healing the psychic nature. How many psychic wounds do we have? We cannot imagine how much we are holding on to inside from childhood. And don't we want to heal all that? The body dies, the psychic structure does not die. It takes on a certain essence and becomes a part of the essence and is carried forward. Do we want to hold on to all that? Or do we want to heal it? And no outside therapist can heal it. It's not possible. It's only a rise in consciousness. The light of consciousness, which when it falls on the wound, then the wound heals miraculously, like Christ's hands, you would touch the leper and they would be healed. It's this inner light of consciousness. So we will see that our inner talking is most pronounced in negative states. Someone has been mean. Someone has not fulfilled a promise. Someone is doing it better than me in business. I remember in 1984, I thought of staying in America. So I went to meet a lawyer. And the lawyer is telling me, at that time I was very much into the Osho movement. And the lawyer is telling me that your guru is going to be kicked out of America. I said, why? So not because what he is speaking or anything, but because he has 90 Rolls Royce cars. So I said, what's the problem with that? So he says, the Americans can take anything, but they can't take you having a better car than them. I had to leave. He had to leave. So, someone is doing better than us. Somebody has better than us. And the inner chatter goes on. And try to see the difference in jealousy and envy. There are different eyes which are jealous eyes, and there are different eyes which are envious eyes. Jealous eyes don't want to hurt the other person. They are jealous. They can't take it that somebody is better. But they are not those eyes who are chattering, let's pull him down. The envious eyes, they want to pull that person down. Ene niche padvani icha. Etle irsha ane dvesh. A banne vache farak che. Ane banne na eyes alag che. Maybe we can make use of the jealous eyes and try to make an extra effort in life to achieve whatever we want to achieve. Right? We can make use of the jealous eyes. And because I have been with at least 3 to 4 gurus, I have seen the way they work. They love to kindle the poor disciples' jealousy. And they weave all these stories. And they tell one disciple to go and tell another disciple something. That you go and tell this person that he has no chance in this life for any progress. And the inner eyes would start talking. And this is the way they work. This is the way they work. So, jealousy is in life, jealousy is in spirituality also. We go to an ashram, there's jealousy there also. Of course, we went to the ashram to be free of jealousy. It happens. So, just see the eyes talking inside. And the envious eyes. The envious eyes, they don't want to make any effort. They are lazy eyes. They just want to pull the other guy down. Then try to see the phrases. Which kind of words do these inner eyes use? What kind of language are they chattering in? And try to, if really somebody were to talk with me in this language, would I stand it for 1 minute? What I am chattering inside of myself? Would I be able to take it for even a minute? Try to ask ourselves that question. This, it can be venomous, poison, what we are talking inside. It's just we take it for granted, so we don't know what we are inside. It's like dung, it's like excreta, and it pollutes the whole psychological structure. So, jara jojo antar, ke ek kai jatni bhasha vapre chhe, ane hakikate avi bhasha je hu andar koi ni mate vapru chhu, jeni mate hu jealous chhu, je time par nathi aayo. જે ભાષા હું અંદર વાપરું છું, કોઈ મારી માટે એવી ભાષા વાપરે તો હું સહન કરું? આ પ્રશ્ન પૂછજો. આસ્ક યોરસેલ્ફ. લેટ અસ ચેન્જ ધ ડેફિનેશન ઓફ લાઈંગ ટુડે. ચેન્જ ધ ડેફિનેશન ઓફ લાઈંગ. લેટ્સ બ્રિંગ અ નેચરલ ડેફિનેશન ટુ ધ વર્ડ લાઈંગ. Not a moral definition to it. Morality is not spirituality. So anything we say that hurts the other is lying. Whether inside or outside. If I snap at my wife, I may be saying the truth in morality. The tea is really cold. I may be saying that what we call the truth, the so-called truth, the relative truth. But if my wife has felt hurt, then I'm lying. And now, in this inner rising of consciousness, because non-violence and consciousness goes together, it is an intrinsic part of consciousness. Our whole effort is to speak in such a way that we never hurt anyone. This is our effort. But that can never happen. We can never reach that state as long as these inner eyes are cutting off somebody's head inside, stabbing somebody inside. It's not possible. It has to start from that inner chakra. Lies are more powerful than any truth because lies are soaked in violence. And truth is soft. Truth is more endurable than any lie. But truth is soft. Truth can never hurt anyone. ऑफ कोर्स जगजीत सिंह सिंग्स इज गजल, सच मुंह से निकल जाता है, कोशिश नहीं करता है. The truth which hurts is a lie. Now, so when we observe inside, try to see what is truth and what is non-truth. And you will see that most of the inner chattering is half-truths and lies. Oh, everything is wrongly connected inside. You felt hurt in the emotional center. But the emotion, the intellectual center is chattering and finding all sly ways to put that person in his place. Everything is wrongly connected. Now, can we hold a feeling of dislike? Can we go back to our memory? અણગમાનું ફીલિંગ આપણે બહાર કાઢી શકીએ સ્મૃતિમાંથી? સમબડી કેમ ટુ આર હોમ, વી ડિડન્ટ લાઈક ઇટ, સમ ગેસ્ટ કેમ, હુમ ડુ વી નોટ લાઈક ઇન આર લાઈવ્સ, મધર ઇન લો, સન ઇન લો, હુમ ડુ વી નોટ લાઈક, હુમ ડુ વી નોટ લાઈક, એન્ડ ટેક ધ પિક્ચર આઉટ. And can you hold that feeling inside, that feeling of dislike? Just, I am in a state of dislike. And can we direct that dislike to our inner talking? That whenever these inner eyes start chattering, I come into a state of dislike. Anugamo. Jare andar bak bak chalu thai, mari andar anugamo chalu thai. Then we'll be able to work with it. Direct dislike to this inner chattering, this inner talking. As long as we like it, as long as I like putting you in your place, how will it stop? Can you see what is happening over here? જ્યાં સુધી મને કોઈને ઠીક કરવું, કોઈને સરખું કરવું અંદર ગમે છે, હા 10 વખત એને સરખું કરવું અંદર, ત્યાં સુધી એ બકબક બંધ જ નહીં થઈ શકે, શક્ય નથી, ઇટ્સ નોટ પોસિબલ. અણગમો આવવો જોઈએ ત્યાં, અને એટલે એ અણગમાની જે ફિલિંગ છે એને આપણે અંદર ડાયરેક્ટ કરીએ. મેની ઓફ અસ, when we look back at our lives and we see what went wrong, what went wrong. Supposing I'll be 59 this year, then I look back, what went wrong? And try to ask this question, okay, was it something wrong outside or was there something wrong inside? It's difficult. It's difficult. But if you can bring consciousness to that point where, just see, wherever you feel you made a wrong decision, wherever you feel, you're 15, 16 years old, you had two girlfriends and you made the wrong decision. You went with this one. Go back. Go back. But Guru used to say only two girlfriends. One is called Smriti, not his wife. Memory. Memory, that is in one hand, memory, and the other is kamna in the other hand. If these two girlfriends fall, you're free. Desire and memory. And if these two girlfriends fall, smriti and kamna, only two chains are binding us, and they fall. Practice in the daytime sometimes. Try to avoid avoid using memory. We'll come to that because we will be coming to Patanjali's where he talks about the vrittis, and one of the vrittis is memory, how to work with memory. Right? So we'll go into that later on. So trying to see the line of time of our lives, je apni jivan ni rekha chhe, e bhutkal ma jyare apne jaye, go back into it and see all the wrong decisions, not as something happened which happened outside, but as something which happened inside, not as an outer event, as an inner event. Then you will see how everything is wrong in our psychic structure. It was absence of being present. It was the absence of being present. The word which is used in the Bible, sin. Sin. Of course, now sin means to do something evil or something. But the original meaning of the word sin was to miss the mark. To miss the mark. Chuki jao. Chuki jao. And just see all those decisions in your life. If you had been present over there, if you had not missed the mark, if your presence was over there in that decision, maybe 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, just bring presence to that decision and you will suddenly see an inner change. You are not present. It has nothing to do with outer circumstances. My father was like this, my mother was like this, my home was like this, my education was like this, my friends were like this. It has none of the fault lies outside. And just that small exercise will change so many things for us, that I was not present, I sinned. Sin. I was not present. Just presence. This simple exercise. Take that presence back in time and bring consciousness to those moments where there was no presence, which happened in darkness. It will lighten up the line of time of our lives. This circle of memory which we call life. It will bring blood into that circulation of memory. It will bring energy into that circulation. Bring a new sensitivity. Then we'll realize that because of this inner chattering all the time, we follow wrong thoughts, we go with the wrong chain of thoughts. We should have gone with that girlfriend, we went with that one. Wrong chain of thoughts, wrong points of view, wrong ideas of what we have to do with our lives. It is because of this inner chattering. It is this inner chattering which is the culprit. And that will change all the wrong decisions we made in our lives. Right. So, this chatter, this inner talk is a symptom of our inner psychological state. And through self-observation, we become aware that we are talking inside all the time. Now, when we observe the inner talking, we will see that it is always a monologue. We are talking. Right? If I've had some problem with her, I am talking alone inside. She's not allowed to talk. She's not there. So, whatever, I have a free hand, I can say whatever I want about her. Free hand. Samjhe che? Eni sathe mane takleef che, pa andar je vak vak thai che, tyare e hajar nathi. Mare jem faave em bolvani chhut che mane. Now, this monologue is always negative. Can we turn it into a dialogue? This is a technique which the guru gives to the disciple. That Try to turn your monologues into dialogues. Bring that person in. Andar le aao. Bring that person into your psychological structure. Say what you want to say, but allow him or her to say it back. Suddenly everything will change. Now, a great deal of this inner talk is putting ourselves right. When my guru was there, I used to go to meet him. He used to stay very near the stock market. So in those days, the stock market would run from 12 to 2. Not like today, it starts at 9:15 in the morning and gets over at 3:30 in the afternoon. 2 hours, Indian stock market would run for 2 hours, 12 to 2. And I was in the stock market. So then I would walk to my guru's house, and it was about a 7 minute walk from the stock market. And as I started practicing self-observation, I would see what the monkeys chattering in that 7 minute walk. And but see, it's always putting things right. So, and the stock market is, it's changing every second, every moment, everything is changing. And you're bound to make mistakes. You're bound. Everything can't be right. You sell something for 2 rupees, within 5 minutes it becomes 4 rupees. Now the monkey is chattering. And you're trying to put it right inside. Maybe you've already sold it for 2 rupees, but inside you will be selling it for 4 rupees. Can you see how this inner chatter? It is always putting things right. You go to a store, right? And you buy something. But then you're, what do you call, surfing the internet. And you say, this was available for half the price. And now the monkey is chattering. It's putting things right. So 100 times inside, those inner eyes will be chattering and they'll buy it from this place at half the price. Not want it really. Can you see how this... Now something touches even deeper. There may be some deal or something, and he comes and tells me that just because of you, this whole deal has got washed away or something. I lost this deal and I lost so much money, and he puts a guilt, a feeling of guilt within me. Now the monkey is chattering, all these eyes come up. And so many of them say, it is not my fault, it is not my fault. And they're trying to set things right. And they're trying to, inside they're making him understand, I am not at fault. He's nowhere there. Can you see how these eyes are talking inside? These are all situations. There was a time, some years ago in India, where there was a shortage of coins. There was a shortage of coins. I don't know whether it was real or what. And you would go to a shop, you buy something, and instead of giving you the change, they give you some sweets. No coins. And the monkey starts chattering. It's nothing. I mean, he's given you some sweets. I mean, you should feel happy. When somebody gets married, you give speeches. But the monkey chatters that he's cheating me. And the monkey is setting things in right inside. That next time when I go to the store, I'll collect all the sweets and give it to him. So all trying to see, these are simple situations in life where we are losing energy, we are losing consciousness. We are losing the most precious thing we have. And it doesn't require big intelligence, it just requires a little bit of knack to see this and start working. And that first samadhi is not very far away. It will give us the taste, the first taste of our inner spiritual journey. Just if we can stop that inner chattering, even for a few minutes, the first taste will come. Then walking on the path is so easy. Then we have tasted that something from the other shore. Just now, I keep on talking, but so, setting things right, justifying. My guru used to say, never defend yourself in life. Let your life speak for itself. This is very difficult. Somebody accuses us of something and not to defend ourselves. But take it as a practice. Take it as a practice. You see, the minute we feel we have not been treated properly, we are already negative. And then all that starts rising out of that is just adding to the negativity. The chain of inner talking. Putting that person properly. Putting ourselves right. And all the inner arguments which come. Okay, how can he do this to me when I'm such a respected member of the society and this and that and all that? Now there are deeper forms of inner talking where we remember old hurts, old gramophone records start coming out. Suddenly they start playing. Old hurts. And I tell you, I worked a lot on this, and through schooling, I tried to go back to each incident, and I used to make a practice for 3 months. I would take, say, 1 year of my life, and try to rearrange that year of the life. Now, in those 3 months, if I got a thought of any other year, I would not allow it. It has to be done in an organized manner. Now, different memories of that year I would allow and I would hold. Memories of any other year for those 3 months, not allowed. And suddenly some old memory would come up like this, and the hands would go like this, and the teeth would go like this. Can you see? It's lying there. It's lying there. And we want to be free of that. And just by this simple practice, I saw that, you know, blood would start flowing in blood vessels which had been blocked for years. Just by taking consciousness into the past, opening up different, healing different wounds, blockages would open up, a different sensitivity would come into life, a different joy would come into life, as if by not opening up that, something was blocking me from enjoying the present moment. I don't know, am I coming across these old wounds in the past? They were as if, you know, poisoning the present. Without my knowledge. Things started changing. And to relive those old hurts and to be free of them. And so much of life, which was totally in the darkness, when I was 4 years old and 3 years old and 2 years old, I've been able to piece together. It's a beautiful exercise. Then we realize where this inner talking is coming from. The roots were sown so long ago. We feel we are talking because she hurt me. But she hurt me, it's opening up a wound which was 30 years old. Which I cannot see. I am blaming her. And if I am free of that wound, she can hurt me. It's okay. So this chain of inner talking, where has it come from? So some of these are wounds are very, very deep. It will take some time. Now, as we hear these inner eyes talking to each other, we will see that all inner talking is personal. All inner talking is personal. Somewhere I am involved. Can we see the self-love? The self-love. I'm not using the word ego. It's the worn-out word. Self-love. That we have different pictures of ourselves and we've fallen in love with those pictures. We don't love anybody else. We only love the pictures we hold inside. We have a picture of ourselves as a good husband, so we feel we love our wife. We don't love our wife. We love the picture we hold as a good husband. And the minute the wife says you are useless, husband, there's irritation. So, that self-love, it is this self-love which is hurt. And it is the minute the self-love is wounded inside, the chattering will start. Either we are trying to put ourselves right in a situation, or something has been hurt inside, something which I imagined myself to be, a picture of myself which I'm holding inside. It could be any picture. I'm a good engineer, a good professional, a good actor, good this, any picture I hold of myself, a good doctor, any picture. And somebody has thrown a stone at that picture and the chattering has started. The person may be known or unknown, is always directed at someone. I used to have one person, because I used to work with, for years I worked with people who were in drugs. And one of them, he used to phone me 5 times a day. And then this morning I've shot God. So you can see that in the end, somebody is responsible. There is always some person over there. Somebody is responsible for my situation in life. Maybe I don't have enough money. Maybe I don't have enough friends. Maybe I don't have enough of this. But in the end, I always hold somebody responsible, either life or God or whatever. But all this inner chatter is very personal. Now, try to see it little further also. That we'll later go on to talk about contradictions. That how we, our psychic structure is full of different contradictions. That I can see something in you which I cannot see in myself. Right? We'll go into that later on. Now, just see this. That I feel she has not treated me well. She has insulted me. And she being young and I'm old and respected, she should have treated me better. And now my chattering has started. And this chattering has started and I'm in the state of dislike inside. I'm in this hostile state inside. Andar abhi, a little bit of violence jivu andar aa rahi hai. You know, I'm feeling a little hostile inside. And some guests come home. How do I treat those guests? Can we see this? That she treated me in this way, I came into this negative state, but I don't see how I, from that negative state, how I treat others. And leave alone others. I may break my cup of tea, or I may shatter a mirror or a plate or God knows what. the treatment of others. My, this is very, this is what Gurdjieff calls as a buffer. That I can see on one side of the wall, but I cannot see on the other side of the wall. I am blind on the other side of the wall. That I am, because of this state I am in, I am automatically treating people in a very bad way. So try to see this, move with this inner chatter and see where it goes in, what it goes into. And don't say it was the plate's fault, why did it come on the way, why did it, when I'm in this mood. So another characteristic of inner chatter, if the other is never at fault, there'll be no inner chatter. The other has to be at fault. Someone, in the end, God has to be at fault. Somebody has to be at fault. I cannot be at fault. I am always right inside. Sometimes there is self-blame, but this is just the other end of the pendulum. It is a, what do you call, opposite way of justifying ourselves. Right? Nobody wants to blame themselves. Now another way, one way of which the Guru teaches us is to make all monologues into dialogues. Another way is to forgive. Can we forgive? What is the meaning of forgive? Can we forgive? Shama, right? Can we cancel? Can we cancel? And the canceling has to happen that very moment. I get a thought, right, that I've been having fever for so many days, right, and none of my friends phoned me up to ask me how are you and all that, and now the eyes are talking inside. Let's see, when times are bad, no friends come and etc. etc. and the eyes start talking inside. And I suddenly wake up. Suddenly there is presence. At that very moment, cancel all the debts. Gone. Cancel me? Really cancel. Whatever money you owe to me, this very moment I have cancelled. If the next moment the thought comes again, I will not cancel it. The minute I cancel it, this inner chattering will that very moment die down. This is called forgiveness. Forgiveness. And we have to practice forgiving. Keep practicing forgiving. Right? And maybe we have to forgive things also. If the car has a puncture or something or that. So forgive things also. Forgive. Get into an inner state of forgiving. If we can see this state a little deeper, this state of forgiving, it is a beautiful state to be. And it is much more valuable than what you owed me. If we look inside and look at the balance sheet inside, andarnu sarvayu jara apne joyiye, try to see, and we will see that we don't owe anything to anybody, but definitely everybody owes us. Me ani mate pan karelu ne teni mate pan karelu ane ana ghare pohchayelu ne. Definitely, we have done so much for it. There must be something wrong if everybody has the same thought. Something wrong. If everybody is old, can we cancel it? Just one moment, write it off completely. Nobody owes me anything. Nobody. Be free. Be free. And a lot of the inner chattering will stop. But it keeps on chattering. You come to my home, I make 6 dishes for you, I go to your home, you make only 2 for me. Then those 4, I've got to extract those 4 whole from you. That pound of flesh, I've got to get it out of you. And they'll keep on reminding me inside that I am old. It's a beautiful state to be. To be in a state where you're not owed anything. Nobody owes you anything. Everything is over in life. Now, because all this happens within us, we feel it is our private matter and nobody knows anything. And so why bother about it? Why bother about it? We don't realize that when we think evil of others, she has insulted me, but each moment I am, you know, thinking bad about her inside. Each moment that I think that I am becoming that evil. Without that, it is not possible. That my inner state, I am becoming that. એને મારી જોડે આવો વર્તન કર્યો છે પણ હું અંદર એને સરખો કરું છું તો જે જે એને કરું છું એ હું બની જાઉં છું. એ બને ત્યારે, પણ એ તો હું તે વખતે બની જ ગયો છું. All the unpleasantness. Can you see, we have a boil on the skin, we feel so feverish inside. But these are psychological boils inside, but we don't feel anything. It's all taken for granted because nobody outside, on the skin at least, they'll have been rubbing antibiotic cream the whole day. Somebody can see it. But this is inside, nobody can see it. We are not bothered. What is this inner psychological country of ours? What state it is in? And we don't realize that it is the gutter also, and it can become divine also. It is in our hands. It is hell also, it is heaven also. In our hands. And if you really want to work on self, if you really want to walk on this inner path, then you will really feel psychologically, I am ill, I want to be free of this. I want to be free of this chatter. Another way to work in dialogue is hold the picture of that person. Hold the picture. Not really. Right? And say what you have to say. Say it. Allow the eyes to say it. And then give that person a chance to say something. Pause. And see how he or she gives it back. Initially, there will be a little difficulty in doing this. But when... See... Small experiment. Supposing my wife is getting very angry with me and saying all kinds of things. Okay, you should have spoken to that person in this way, and you should have done this over here, and you should have done that over here. And she's also working on herself, so she's also on the path. Right? So I just say that, why are you so negative? Why are you so? Yes, I am negative. I am negative. Let me look inside. So we have this picture of this person whom we are saying all these things, and just allow that person to say back to us, so why are you negative? And suddenly we'll relax inside. And why am I going on this line of thinking? Why am I following these thoughts? Why am I saying I to these thoughts? These thoughts are not me. They've come from the gutter. The psychological gutter which I'm holding inside. They are not me. I don't want to become a part of them. So just by holding that picture, letting him or her say something. Let him or her say something back. Why are you like this? Even one small lie. Why are you enjoying being negative? Why are you enjoying being negative? Suddenly everything will stop. There will be a pause over there. The eyes will, for that moment in time, the eyes will stop. And we get a moment to work inside, to observe inside. Which part of town was I going through? I was going through the worst part of town. And I was allowing all these thieves and people to work or take everything away from me. They were hypnotizing me each moment. And then I'll wake up. Another thing will happen. Just as the majority of inner eyes want to take us lower down in life, want to make us more mechanical in life, want us to lose consciousness, there is a group of eyes which want to work on self, which want to rise in life, which want to rise in consciousness, which want to be free of the hypnotism of life. They want us to be free and they want to help. Now the minute we put the picture there and we say to the picture and we allow that picture to speak to us, we'll suddenly see as those mechanical eyes calm down, some work eyes, some eyes will come to help us. They say, move on this path. And there'll be a moment of silence in between. Between this happening and that happening, there'll be a moment of silence. Two waves. When each wave neutralizes the other, in that in-between space, you're neither here nor there. Silence. Many years ago, when I was very young and there was a flood in Madhavpur, and the river would be in flood, and we would jump into the river and come to the sea, and the sea would neutralize us and we would come out. And there's so much force in the river water. Anyway, 20 years after that, in 2001, I tried to do the same thing. The sea took me away. Luckily, I came back. That's good. But in between two waves, there's this inner space. You said it's like a miracle where the river with so much force is taking you and suddenly everything is neutralized. Suddenly you were going on this inner train of thought and suddenly just it's dropped over there. There's a peace, there's a calm. This is inner silence. There's something in us which is totally silent. We can just touch that. And that will happen when two forces neutralize each other. In between those two forces is what we call Akash, space, the empty space. That is why we call Yudhishthir. He's sthir. Sthir means steady. He's there in that space where the two waves meet. Yudhishthir. So, there are eyes in us which want to take us deeper into the hypnosis of life, the mechanical eyes, but there's a small group which wants to take us higher, help us to go higher. And the minute those eyes pause for a moment and these eyes come, there's that empty space, we experience that inner silence and we start rising in consciousness. This is the moment of our freedom. They will ask us, why are you so negative? They will remind us what is happening every time we are negative, what we are losing, what is happening in our psychological space. It's not worth holding a grudge against anyone. It's not worth holding a prejudice against. It's not worth holding those wounds in the memory. Because it is pulling us down into the gutter of life, into the quicksand of life. We don't want to remain there. We want to rise up the ladder of consciousness. And in that inner moment, when the inner talking stops, when everything is still, we'll experience that deep silence. When everything is silent, and still everything is as powerful as it can be. Stop over here. We'll continue this same sutra tomorrow. We'll look at different, more with eyes inside. Right? Thank you. Good night. Jai Shri Krishna.
Exactly.
Breath is in the present moment. Presence is in eternity. Whether breath is there or not, presence is always there. Whether body is there or not, presence is always there. Whether mind is working or not, presence is always there. It is this presence which is God. I am Aham Brahmasmi. Hold both the feelings, presence and present. The breath is the present, Purushat Prakriti. Slowly the music will stop. Continue holding both the feelings. We are together for the next 1.5 hours. Try to hold your presence throughout the talk. Be present. Observe yourself sitting. Observe yourself listening. And observe yourself when your mind moves away into some dream. Slowly open your eyes. I'm going to repeat some of the things which were said this morning in the Gujarati session. The first thing which we said is, if we wanted to make our aim in life simple, how would we phrase our aim in life? What is our aim in life? We want to just make it very simple. So how will we phrase our aim in life? I won't repeat this in Gujarati because I took it in the morning in the Gujarati session. So, what is our aim in life? What is our aim in life? Can we put it that our aim in life is to be free of reaction? Is to be free of reaction. The mind, for thousands and thousands of years since man has been on this planet, has developed this deep sanskar, this deep memory pattern, the deepest habit of the mind, the deepest attitude of the mind to react. This is a lifetime's work to be free of reaction. We understand it intellectually very easily. And then we just take it for granted. So, can we say that we want to be free of reaction? We want to change the structure of the mind, change the quality of the mind, the mind's inherent habit to react. We will call this habit to react because we are doing the Yoga Sutra. We will interpret this line, Yoga Chitta Vritti Nirodhaha, to stop the habitual mechanical reaction of the mind, this habitual pattern of the mind to react. And reactions are of two kinds. One, where we express it outside, and one which goes on more subtly in the mind. And we want to be free of both. Of course, the first step would be not to react outside. Can we examine ourselves every day before we go to sleep at night, that did I react, at least outside, did I express a negative reaction today? And try to mark yourself. This is the basic thing, the most basic. As long as there is an expression of negativity, I cannot move even one step on the spiritual path. Both these cannot go together. It's not possible. Everything is in vain. So, every night we will ask ourselves that today did I react anywhere, at least expressly? And then we will try to see inside. That did I react inside? Now this is very difficult, because it needs a constant inner light, an inner, line of light inside, inner ray of light inside, what we call as self-observation. I may be talking to you, and I seem friendly with you, and it is so nice talking to you, but suddenly you are talking about some of your achievements. And I don't even see that a shadow of jealousy crossed over the surface of the mind. It went through the mind. And I don't even see it. And it reacted. We keep on talking about the divine. We keep on talking about God. But till the mind is free of reaction, it cannot become a container to hold God. It's not possible. That very reaction is like a vomiting out. It is not ready. All talk about God is useless till the mind is ready to receive that God, till the mind is so free of that pattern of reaction that the reflection of God is always there. God is for us. We don't have to do anything for God. Divine is. It is our inherent nature. But the mind is not ready to receive it. All the effort is on cleansing the mind, on cleansing the mind of the patterns and patterns of reaction. And this is a long journey. It's not a difficult one. It's not a difficult one, but it needs constancy. It needs a certain kind of regular, everyday effort without any intermission. So all change begins with our reactions to an actual day. We do not see that nothing changes in life for us. Every day we live the same day. We may go for a new movie. We may go for a holiday to the hill station. If we could observe inside, if we could see inside our own thoughts and feelings, then we would say the same things repeat every day. Nothing changes inside. If at home I complain about a cup of tea, on the hill station I'll complain of how cold it is. Nothing changes inside. And unless there is an inner transformation, unless there is an inward revolution, to live with Swami Ram Dulare Bapu. And he had these one-liners, these beautiful one-liners of his. And actually we printed a book of one of his 108 of his one-liners that we printed. We call it 108. And one of his one-liners was, Shanti chahiye, shanti to kabristan mein hai. Kranti karo to shanti milegi. You want peace, then peace is in the graveyard. Unless there is an inner transformation, unless there is an inner revolution inside, kranti, then real peace. Our peace is always dependent on something. We sit in meditation and somebody blows a horn and the meditation goes away. Right? Or it's too cold and too hot. If the food is good, then okay, maybe we are a little happy. Right? But if they're brinjals, then again. So, our peace is always dependent on something outside. Our happiness is always dependent on something outside. We are slaves. We are living a life of slavery. And if life is good, maybe we are happy. But can we be happy when life is totally against us? Then our happiness is independent of the circumstances of life. Then this happiness is a quality of our inner being. But for that we have to be free of the slavery of the mind. So, all practice begins today. Please do not say, I'll keep these ideas in a cupboard and maybe sometime in the future, I'm going to practice. It starts from now. Please understand that one day is one unit of time for us. One day is one unit of time. If nothing changes for me today, then tomorrow is just a recurrence of this unit of time. It is a recurrence, a reincarnation of that unit of time. Everything in life recurs. We can't see it. We don't observe it. In one line of time, we have a life from birth to death. In another line of time, we are recurring. And these are two different lines of time. The cell has a life, say, maybe of 6 minutes. So 6 minutes of that cell is equal to 70 years of us. It is the same scale. Try to understand. From our five senses, we are taking in 30,000 impressions every second, which are later translated into 120 thoughts. So, in that 1 second, we are taking 30,000 impressions. Can you imagine in a lifetime how many impressions we are taking? The cell takes in the same amount of impressions that we take in 70 years in 6 minutes. So the life of the cell of 6 minutes is equal to 70 years of us. And the cell is traveling from here to here. And in 6 minutes it dies. And what happens? A similar cell comes to take its place. The memory of the old cell is transferred to the memory of the new self. And it continues the work. So one line of time has died, but in another line of time the same cell has recurred. And this is the law in the universe. Whether it is from the smallest cell to the biggest galaxy, everything in one line of time is born and dies. In another line of time it continually recurs. And to understand this, we must take an arrow of attention within us and see that today this jealousy has recurred. It is not in our normal line of time. Please understand this. We cannot see its birth and death. We cannot see when the jealousy was born. We may feel, okay, my girlfriend was looking at somebody else, that's why I got jealous. It's not true. It's not true. It was lying there from the beginning. The girlfriend was just an excuse for it to come out of the subconscious mind into the conscious mind. I was already jealous in the first place. Only I imagined that I was not. And that jealousy is not living in normal time. There is no birth and death. There may be a birth and death in my conscious mind where it comes from the subconscious mind. It expresses itself in my conscious mind as jealousy. I get jealous. It reinforces itself and goes back into the unconscious mind. And this process goes on. It is in a different line of time. If I can understand that jealousy, I'll understand all my births. There's no need to go for past life regression and I don't know all this load of techniques which are going on. They don't mean anything. You just have to learn to look inside. Because they are moving in a different time. And if I can see inside, then everything is moving in recurrence. Everything keeps on recurring. And I want to be free of this law. It's very easy to say that I want to be free of the law of birth and death. But inside, am I free of jealousy? Then I can be free of the law of birth and death. So far away. It's easy to talk. We sing the bhajan, punarupi jananam, punarupi maranam. Doesn't mean anything. We don't even know what he's singing about. So all practice begins with today, now. Am I willing to practice today? If I can't practice today, then tomorrow is just a recurrence of today and day after is just a recurrence of that same unit of time. My life will be over, nothing will be done. And many people have all these imaginary concepts that I want to practice, but after I earn so much money. And people come to me that in my young days I can't do spirituality, so first I'll earn so much. And they don't realize it's not whether you earn money or you don't earn money. It's how you're living the present moment that is spiritual or non-spiritual. It has nothing to do with money. It has nothing to do with what you're doing in your outer life. You may be a politician, you're very famous. And you may be cleaning boards in the schoolroom, you're not famous. It does not matter. But it doesn't mean that the politician is very spiritual. Spirituality is how I relate myself to the present moment, nothing else. And if that relationship is negative, I may go to the temple, I may do pujas, I may do everything. But as long as that relationship remains negative, nothing changes. And all you have to do is how the wife is reacting, you ask the husband, and you ask the wife how the husband is reacting, you know the picture. I've been teaching for 20 years, and people come to me, I'm sitting in meditation, and I got this experience and that experience, and saw light over here, and saw light over there. I say, wait, has your wife come? Is she with you? Please call her. Does he get angry? Does he get irritated? Just tell me. Say, definitely. And when somebody disturbs him in meditation, he gets the most irritated. We don't know where we are going. So we must notice the little events of the day. Nothing will happen in the future. It has to happen now. how we think and feel in each moment. And we will see that we are totally governed by a set of reactions, mechanical reactions. We are mechanical reactions, we are not ourselves. This whole inner network of reactions, they make us see life in a certain way. Now, I've been talking about self-observation, so today we are going to go a little further. And to make it a little easy, because when I say that when you look inside, there are hundreds and hundreds of people inside of us, and nobody can, you know, sort of grasp this concept. So we will say, try to divide things inside into five centers. To five centers. એટલે જે સેલ્ફ ઓબ્ઝર્વેશનની આપણે જે વાત થોડા દિવસથી કરીએ છીએ એમાં મદદરૂપ થવા માટે આપણે અંદર જ્યારે જોશું તો આપણી જાતને પાંચ સેન્ટરમાં વેચી દઈશું. હકીકત વેચી નહીં જાય, આ હકીકત છે. ધીસ ઇઝ ધ ફેક્ટ. વી આર ફાઇવ ડિફરન્ટ સેન્ટર્સ ઇનસાઇડ. વી કેન make many analogies out of this. We can say that in one flat there are five different people living. Each one does not understand the language of the other person. The problem is all speak English, right? But there is an intellectual center who speaks his own language. When I'm talking to you, initially these ideas touch your intellectual center. But then there's an emotional center which speaks its own language. And both are using English. Or whatever language you're using. And then there is a moving center. There is an instinctive center. And there is a sex center. These are five centers in us. When we study the Mahabharata, we will see that Bhim is the sex center. Nakul is the moving center. Sahadev is the instinctive center. Arjun is the emotional center. And Yudhishthir is the intellectual center. These are five centers. Please do not mix them up with chakras. Please do not mix them up. Chakras is a different language. Initially, I made the same mistake when I heard these ideas, so it's okay. Absolutely okay. And I was trying to find some, synchronicity, some analogy between the chakras and the centers are not chakras. I'll just give you one example. Supposing we take the Muladhara chakra, right? And we say that the Muladhara chakra has Prithvi Tattva, the element called earth. The element called earth. Now this earth element has many, many manifestations, many manifestations. Try to hold your presence, because when I look at your eyes, I know where you are. And that's my thing. And I know that you've gone roaming somewhere. So try to hold your presence. Okay. Now, supposing one of the manifestations of the earth element is to stop. You put a stone in front of water, it stops the water. So we say to stop. Right? So in the moving center, I'm walking along the road. Right? and I hear a loud sound, so I stop. Now this is a manifestation of earth element in the moving sector. Right? Now, I'm going through so many ideas, but I can't relate one idea to another idea. And suddenly I come upon a common ground where I see in this background all these ideas fit into this picture. Right? So that is a manifestation of earth element in the intellectual sector. I may be all alone. It was a depressing rainy day, so I'm depressed and lonely. And you come and uplift me, then this is a manifestation of earth element giving support in the emotional center. So don't mix these with chakras. This is a completely different science. It's not come from traditional yoga. It's not come from traditional yoga. Right? So we will say that we will take an analogy that we are living in a flat or a home in which there are five rooms and each one is occupied by a different person and they cannot understand each other even though they speak the same language. They cannot understand each other. It's like the mind has five windows and from each window you see a different scene. So somebody says it's going to rain today, but somebody from the other window can't see any clouds, so he's going to say it's a sunny window and they're both fighting with each other. And this is the story of our life. So these are not five windows, they are not five people. We don't have one mind, we have five minds. We have five minds. Now, when we observe inside, when we say we are many people inside, we are not one person, at least now we can divide into five. Where did this thought come from? Did the thought originate in the intellectual center? Did it come from the emotional center? Did it come from the instinctive center? Or did it come from the moving center? Was it about something to do? Then it is from the moving center. But it was about having a good meal, and all that. Then it was from the instinctive center. It could be about a feeling towards another person, then from the emotional center. It could be something to do with philosophy or something, then it is from the intellectual center. So now, when we are observing inside, at least we can say, these thoughts, this thought is from this center, this thought is from this center. So now, at least we can say, these eyes, this eye lives in the intellectual center, this eye lives in the emotional center. Now things become a little easy. Now, this is a very deep science of centers. And each center is divided into positive, negative, and then into three parts, and then into three more parts. But I won't take those parts this year. Next year, if with God's grace we can meet, I'm going to talk about the playing cards. The playing cards. So we talk about the four suits, hearts, spades, diamonds and clubs. And we'll divide the centers into their different parts. And each playing card will represent a part of a center. So if he's saying something to me, I know from which center, which part it is coming. I'll say he's five of clubs. Right? So that is, these playing cards which we use are not just playing cards. It's a very deep esoteric science. Right? So we'll do that. But just now I won't go into the divisions of centers. But we will have to divide it into positive and negative. At least this much we will have to divide the centers inside. So now, when we are looking inside, we are starting our journey of self-observation. we now see that when we are looking inside, we are at least five different people. There's a thinking person, there's a feeling person, there's a sensing person, there's a moving person. And we'll keep out the sex center just now because it's very difficult to understand the sex center. And each center works with a different kind of petrol, a different kind of energy. Some works with a higher energy, some work with a lower energy, subtle energy. So now at least we come to the thing that we have five different minds in us. We are not one mind. Centers are like well-designed machines, very delicate, and they are designed for a specific purpose and specific use. Now, later on I will talk about associations, that over these five centers there is a network of telephone lines, a network of telephone lines. And everywhere there is a wrong number. So our centers are not working properly. They are not working in a balanced way. And the wrong impression goes to the wrong center. Let us take one impression. That he insults me. Now this is an impression coming into the mind. It comes in through the ear. As a sound, the words he uses. It comes in through the eyes, his demeanor, his posture, the way he looks at me, whether his nose is sneering up or down or whatever. Right? And this whole thing is coming in as a packet of energy, like a quantum. It's coming in as a packet of energy. Right? And later on we will see what this packet of energy contains. My guru gave it a name, an incoming impulse. An incoming impulse. And it definitely contains so many things. From lower to higher, it contains so many energies. So many different combinations. So it is this prana which is coming in through the five senses. Now, it is supposed to go to my intellectual center. Where does it go? To the emotional center. I say, he insulted me, and then life is a mess. Life is a mess. Can you see? All the connections are wrong. The wrong thing is sent to the wrong place. The right thing to the wrong place. And it takes a long time of inner observation to come to a point where the centers are working properly in a balanced way. For years I was in the stock market, and you would always come back and say, oh, I got hypnotized by this deal. And then later on when I learned the science of the centers, I suddenly realized what should have gone to my intellectual center went to my emotional center. This person said, buy this, in the next 5 minutes it's going to double. Right? And I got hypnotized. In the emotional center started working. Right? And in 5 minutes, instead of doubling, it became half. Right? Story of our lives. So, everything is going to the wrong place, and it is because of this network what we call associations. See, we can't see associations because the mind is chattering all the time. When we go in, this inner chatter, this inner talk which we talked about in our last talk, is going on all the time, so we can't go a little deeper and see associations. But sometimes we can become aware of associations. We are sitting in meditation and just try to see how these associations work. Everywhere there is a wrong number. I'm sitting in meditation, a horn of somebody's car goes off on the street, right? And it associates that I have not cleaned the glass of my car, right? But yesterday I wanted to clean the glass, but then at that time he came to meet me, and he comes at all these useless times, right? Can you see? Everywhere there's a wrong number. And don't think that these association, this chain of associations happened because of the horn. They are now also, as you're sitting here, there is one layer of the mind, the river of the mind, where these associations are flowing fast. Only we can't see them. And in sleep, when the chattering slows down, the chattering quietens down, and sometimes the inner eye opens up a little, we see these associations, and they take certain forms of maybe some animals or something or some scenery, and we say, oh, in my dream I saw this. It's just these associations working out in different forms, in different scenery. So there's a whole level of the mind where these associations, they are a network of connections, and they've connected everything in us in a wrong manner. So all of us have these highly complex machines within us, and we don't know how to use them properly. We spend our whole lives hardly using a part of these five minds which we have. We don't even know the tremendous power of the sex center. Maybe more than any atomic explosion. And we only waste it in negativity. I get angry. My emotional center connects to the sex center, and I find the energy to get angry on it. What a waste. What a waste. So, this idea that we are five minds also helps us to break the illusion that we are one person. We are five people inside. Now, when we come to man, we will see that there are three types of people, usually 3 to 4 types of people. I won't write it on the board, but take man as a three-storied building. The top story is the intellectual center, the middle story is the emotional center, and the ground floor is the instinctive moving sex, the ground floor, right? These are three stories in man. Now, normal man or woman, whatever, his center of gravity of consciousness is always in one center. So he looks at life through one window, and he cannot see life from the other four windows. And life is a collage. Life is not just one scenery from one window. It is a collage. You have to paste everything together. What you see from the emotional window, what you see from the instinctive window, what you see from the intellectual window. You have to paste. And that pasted collage is the truth. But when we are seeing life through one window, it is never the truth. આપણે જો જીવનને એક જ સેન્ટરમાંથી જોશું, બાકી આપણે એ રીતે જોઈએ કે મનુષ્યનું સેન્ટર ઓફ ગ્રેવિટી, એનું હોવા પણ કોઈ પણ એક સેન્ટરમાં વધારે પડતું હોય છે, ઇન્ટેલેક્ચ્યુઅલ ઇમોશનલ મૂવિંગ, અને એની લીધે એને એક જ બારીમાંથી જિંદગી દેખાય છે. અને જીવનનું જે સત્ય છે એ પાંચે બારી ભેગા કરીએ તો જીવનનું સત્ય થાય. Now try to see this, that one man lives through the intellectual center. He loves to argue. He loves to read philosophy. He loves to read lofty books. So he's seeing life through the intellectual center. Of course, then he gets married to a girl who sees life from the emotional center. She likes to feed someone, right? She likes to entertain some people. She likes to look after the home, iron the clothes, do things. So she's seeing life from a different window, and the man is seeing life from a different window. Right? And there are people who are heavily centered in the emotional center. Their love can become very aggressive. Too much love also becomes aggressive. But you have not finished eating one part of the vegetable, but another spoon comes in immediately. Right? Aggressive love. So, these are people who are centered in the emotional center. People centered in the intellectual center, people centered in the emotional center. People centered in the moving center. They always have to do something. They love adventure, they love sports. They can't sit in one place for even 5 minutes. I used to have one guy who used to come to my lectures. And he would ask a question sitting over here, and I would go to answer the question. I'm looking over there, he's not over there any longer. And when I see he's come over here, he's sleeping over here. Can't sit in one place, he's centered in the moving center. So, now, the intellectual person may feel he is superior to the emotional person, and the emotional person may feel he is superior to the moving person, and then maybe somebody who is centered in the instinctive center. He loves to enjoy life, eat, drink, be merry, the good things in life, centered in the instinctive center. Now, what we are working on for over here is a balanced human being who is able to use each center in a proper manner. So all these three, whether they are in the intellectual, whether they are in the emotional, or whether they are in the moving instinctive, they are on the same level. There is no consciousness. The intellectual, one may be a big scientist. He may have propounded big theories and won big prizes. But he knows nothing about the emotional center. When he comes home, he may be getting upset on his wife, even worse than just an ordinary man, with all his knowledge. With all his knowledge. Right? So, all these three are the same. They are at the same level of humanity. There is no consciousness. Try to see, because I observe these emotional center types. They are always going from one bhajan mandali to another bhajan mandali. There is no consciousness. And you have to see what you are doing inside. Now, man number four. Man number one, the moving center man number two, the emotional center man number three, the intellectual center man, and man number four, who is the one who has suddenly realized that I can observe the working of the centers. And in the observation of the working of the centers over a period of observation, he suddenly realizes that each is trying to steal the other's work. Right? A person gets married, the intellectual center guy gets married, and he says that, okay, now let me find a manual on love, how to love my wife. Love comes from the heart. Just to find a manual, how to love. So, suddenly he now realizes that this is not a function of the intellectual center. It is not a function of the intellectual center. Tell it to shut up. You see, this happens all the time. My guru was teaching me the use of the pendulum. How to use the pendulum. I don't think last year we talked on the law of the pendulum. We'll go one day into the law of the pendulum. And so I was going away for a trip somewhere. So I said, "Sir, is there any book I can read on the pendulum?" He's looking at me like this. He said, "I'm here teaching you." Of course, I'm sure that's what was going on in his mind. "And you want to read a book?" Now, everything that could be learned was in front of me. There was nothing beyond that. I mean, he was such a person. It's so difficult because when you talk about your guru, your ego gets inflated as a disciple. So you have to be careful, right? So, he could see through everything. And he just closed his eyes and he says, "Go to Strand Bookstore." And I went to Strand Bookstall and I opened the door of Strand Bookstall and there were boxes piled up there. And one box was kept like this so we could see it, the pendulum kit. Pendulum kit. Now, the pendulum cannot be understood by the intellectual center. It is something which is higher in the emotional center which understands the pendulum. We haven't come to that as yet. But there is the intellectual center and the emotional center have a higher part which is not opened. But when that opens, we are able to use the pendulum in our daily living to answer questions, to find your way out of problems, etc. And here I am trying to understand that from my normal, ordinary, intellectual center. See, I'll give you one example. One is the formatory intellectual center, which we all use, the formatory. It is very basic, it's the idiot. But we think very highly of it, because we've got all our degrees and etc. etc. So my son was planning to, you know, go to some university to study for his master's. And he's applying to this university and that university. So then some offer came to him that, "Would you like to do an apprenticeship over here?" So he came to me and he says that, "Do I follow up on this offer?" So I told him that everything you are doing from your logical mind. This offer which has come to you has come from beyond the logical mind. Don't try to see it through the light of the logical mind. The logical mind reduces everything to rubbish. Am I now coming across what I'm trying to say? That there is a higher intellectual center, where logic, reasoning, there are blockages to enter there. There are blockages to enter there. I don't know if you've heard the story of Pandu. Pandu was the father of the five Pandavas. And this Sanskrit word, mrigaya, the normal meaning means to hunt. The king has gone on mrugna shikar, he has gone for hunting the deer. That is the normal meaning which comes in the stories and all. Excuse me. Now, the deeper meaning is to go on an inner quest. To go on an inner quest. That is, you're in such a state that something from the higher will come. And everybody has experienced this. Maybe you're sitting at 3 or 4 in the morning, early morning, and suddenly some thoughts, they start flowing which answer all your problems. They have not come through logical reasoning. All of us have experienced this. Only we are not available to this. So Pandu goes on shikar. And he sees these two deer, this pair of deer copulating. Now, this is all very symbolic. It's very, very symbolic. Now, for a young child, it is a story. But when we look at it with a different attitude, a different mind, we put our logical thinking on the side, we put our sensual thinking on the side, then suddenly so many things come up out of this small story. And he shoots the deer. And the deer is not a deer. It is a Rishi and his wife who are enjoying each other's company. But they took on the form of a deer, Mrugaya, the word, to go to hunt deer, Mrugaya, to go to hunt deer. But the deeper meaning, a quest. And he shoots them, and the Rishi gives him a shrap, a curse, that when you go to have sex with your wife, you will die. Right? Now this is the story in the Mahabharata. But try to go deeper into the story, that when we are in that state where something comes from the higher, the Mrugaya, and when that something comes from the higher, it is highly orgasmic. It is very orgasmic. And in that state, if our lower logical mind comes in between, then we kill the higher. We kill the higher. You see? If my son had said that this apprenticeship offer has come from some stupid person, he doesn't know anything, then he would have, something which had come from the higher, he would have killed it and got cursed. He would have been fallen into. I don't know if I'm able to express what I'm trying to express, right? So, the intellectual center which we are so proud of and which we use all the time, on the path it is a radiance. Right? But there's a higher intellect. Later on we will come to the sutra where Patanjali talks about something called Pragna. But before that there is a higher emotional. Patanjali will talk about something called Vivek. Vivek is the feeling of truth. Pragna is the knowing of truth. And truth opens up in these two stages. First there is a feeling of truth, then there is a knowing of truth. And Patanjali says, Tasya da saptada prant bhumi pragna. This pragna, this knowing of truth opens up in seven stages. So we have these lower centers and we have two higher centers, the higher emotional, the higher intellect. The higher emotional is in a way clairvoyant. It knows beforehand. Now, don't take knowing at exactly which lottery number is going to come, he's going to know. It has nothing to do with that. That happens in the serials. Which was that serial? Touch. Which where the young kid knows the lottery number from. It doesn't happen. Right? Okay. But the emotional center knows that, okay, do it over here. It should be done over here. When the reasoning does not come in the way. Now, our emotional center is not knowing here. It is not that feeling of truth. Our emotional center is like and dislike. Right? So, that is not the feeling of truth. Like and dislike has no place over there. It is only when we rise above like and dislike that this can come. This inner clairvoyance of the emotional center. I'm getting digressed a lot. was with Swami Ram Dulare Bapu. One day we were driving from Madhopur to Ahmedabad. So we had passed Rajkot and we were going towards Ahmedabad. And the petrol gauge on the car, because I was driving, the petrol gauge was empty. So I said, Bapu, to fill petrol. No, no, go ahead. Fill petrol. Now the car will fill petrol. Can you go ahead? Keep driving. And then suddenly he tells me, okay, take it into this petrol pump. So he went into that petrol pump. He said, fill it full. And I told the person to fill it up. And then from the opposite direction, from Ahmedabad, one car comes. And from there, one person from Rajkot, very famous fruit seller, it was called Pannalal fruit seller in Rajkot. And today also, Pannalal is not living, but his fruits are the most famous fruit stall in Rajkot. So, he gets out of the car, this Pannalal bhai, and he sees in this, Arey, Bapu is over here, and he falls at his feet, and he's his guru. And then the time comes to pay for the petrol, and of course we've had a full tank, right? And he says, no Bapu, you cannot pay for the petrol, I'll pay for the petrol, right? And he pays for the petrol. So, then I'm taking the car out, and then Bapu says, see, was that the right petrol pump? Says, I see things from the heart, I don't see things from the head. This whole age, we are centered in the head. We don't even know what the heart can do. There's no affection left. The juice of the heart is gone. The raw material for love is affection, lagni. The raw material for love. But there's nothing left over there. It's all dry. Anyway, so these are the five centers, and man can be in any one of these five centers, right? Now, man number four, man number one we saw moving, instinctive, man number two emotional, man number three intellectual, man number four, the one who has realized and is now trying to send each impression to the right center. Now, try to see this. This man number four, how he is working, we'll go back to the same example. He has insulted me. I'm feeling upset. But at the same time, I'm observing inside. Now, I'm not man number one, two, or three. Right? If I was man number one, two, or three, I would go with my anger. I would be hypnotized by the emotional center. I would see that I would be hypnotized by the emotional center, and I would express my anger to him, right? But now I'm observing inside, and I see that the emotional center is angry. It is disappointed. It is feeling hurt inside the emotional center, and I can see that it is trying to pull me in a certain direction, to become negative. And if I become negative, then I've been hypnotized, identified with the emotional center. I can see this inside. So I'm working on myself. Now I'm man number four. So what do? I send that impression from the emotional center to the intellectual center. I said, ponder upon it. Ponder upon it. He may have been a little late in traffic or something. Or maybe his wife said something to him when he was leaving home. Right? He has not said it to me. It's just a reaction out of what his wife told him. Right? Just ponder upon it. Now, this is right working of the centers. Right? And in that, the intellectual center keeps reminding us inside that what is your aim? Your aim is to be free of reaction. The aim is to be free of, and if you go with the emotional center, if you allow the emotional center to take charge of you, then you will increase the power of that reactive sanskar, that reactive pattern which lies in the mind. And instead of becoming free of it, it will become more powerful. You'll become a slave of it. right? So this is how man number four will work. He'll be observing each thing and he'll try to send each impression of life to its right center. A point will come when he'll become man number five. Then he'll become man number five. Now each center is working in the right way. The impressions which are coming from outside are not going to the wrong number. They are going to the right center. Later on we will see that each center has an external part, a middle part and a deep part. And we will see that we are living most of our lives only in the external part of the centers. We can't go deep into the centers. Later on we will allow the impressions of life to go into deeper parts of centers. So there are many eyes inside. These are like homes, these centers. There are intellectual eyes, and out of the intellectual eyes, many of them are very superficial. They're living on the external side of the intellectual center. Many of them are living in the middle side and many of them are deep. So he will allow this, this impression that he has hurt me not to go to the external side. He will allow it to go deeper into the center and the deeper eyes will ponder over it. And from that, he will then respond to it. This is right action. Now right action is coming. So, man number four will start this process, and man number five, suddenly all the centers have started coming into balance. In man number six, the higher part of the emotional center will start now sending messages to the other centers. There's a communication and the other centers will be receiving messages from that higher. So if man number six were to see this insult, the higher part of the emotional center would see his tone of voice. The higher part of the emotional center through the eyes would see his demeanor, the way he is gesturing. It would feel the words, the tone in the words, the aggressiveness in the words. And it would know immediately what are the blockages inside. It would know immediately. The person would be an open book. Whether this is coming out of self-love, whether it is coming out of self-pity, whether it is coming out of vanity. Why has he said these words to me? Which part of his false personality is it coming out of? And suddenly everything will be an open book. He will know what the remedy is for that person. So that will be man number six. The higher part of the emotional center has opened up, which we call as Vivek. Patanjali says, Tarakam Sarva Vishayam Sarvatha Vishayam Vivek Jam Gyan. This Vivek, this feeling of truth, this feeling of truth which has opened up in the higher emotional center, it is Tarakam. Tarakam means it is that knowledge which can take us from this shore to that shore. Taru. It can lead the boat from this shore to that shore. It is that inner light has now opened. The higher emotional center. It is over. It takes the boat from this shore to that. Sarva Vishayam. It now does not need any knowledge from books. The knowledge flows in the present moment, relating to the present moment. It knows. Sarvatha Vishayam. Not all, but all possible knowledge. Not just knowledge of now, all knowledge, but all possible knowledge also. When he says, this Vivek, this inner Vivek, this inner light, this higher emotional center, when it opens up, it is filled with this knowledge. Vivek Jam Gyanam, it is filled with this knowledge of light. This is a different knowledge. This knowledge has not come from, it has come from a different source. Don't think there is some library somewhere. As we observe ourselves, a different knowledge will come. This knowledge will not come from any books. You will hurt your, you'll bang your toe against a table and little blood will come out and you'll feel pain. And suddenly you will relate it. In the morning I was cursing him in my mind for 15 minutes and you will relate it. Oh, that is what led me to this. Now this is a different knowledge. Suddenly you will see the inner connection between inner events and outer events. You will see the inner invisible connections which connect everything in life. The higher emotional. This is man number 6. He now feels truth. And then man number 7, he not only feels truth, he can see the truth. He knows the truth. Sat, Chit, Anand. Chit means to know. The knowing of truth. Every moment there is complete knowledge of truth. This is man number 7. When we read the Bhagavad Gita, when we go into the Mahabharata, Arjun is man between man number 4 and man number 5. And it is Krishna, man number 7, who is trying to catch his hand and lead him on to the opening, the feeling of truth, to the knowing of truth. So, these are the centers within us. Try to see inside, and each thought, each emotion, try to see where it has originated. Which I is saying it? Is it an I of the emotional center? Is it an I of the intellectual center? Because I have not divided the centers, don't try to relate that this thought can only come from the intellectual center. In a way you are right, but the intellectual center also has an emotional part. So don't get into that just now. Just now just say this is from the emotion, this is from the thinking, this is from the moving to do, and this is from the instinct. Just see. So suddenly a lot of inner light will come. Things will start falling in their right place. Things will start falling in the right. And suddenly you will see that you are eating a meal, you should be with your instinctive center, but you are reading a book at the same time. And there's a fight between the two centers. Right? You're not enjoying your food, and you're not in the intellectual center also properly. And so many things will start becoming clear. So you will be reading a novel and you will see how the novel is so exciting. So exciting, and how it is draining the intellectual center. That very excitement is draining the intellectual center of all its energy. All these law, inner workings will start becoming apparent. So, we will then start using the right center for the right occasion, right moment. Still have some time? For the lower to understand the higher is very, very difficult. The disciple comes to the teacher, but there is no way he can comprehend the teacher. The disciple cannot remain in the present moment also. He's daydreaming all the time. And the teacher has moved away from the present moment. He's working in a time called eternity. It's very difficult for the lower to comprehend the higher. When the inner higher emotion and the higher intellect start opening up for a person who is still stuck in his logical brain, still stuck in his reasoning mind, it's very difficult to comprehend. For that we have to put our sensual thinking on the side and try to think in a different way, try to think in analogy. Try to think in metaphorically. Right? Then we will understand what is coming from the higher. This knowledge which I am transmitting to you, it is coming through me. It has come from some very high source. So initially it looks very, very difficult because we try to assimilate it with our logical mind. But a point will come when we will feel this knowledge. And when we feel it, we will feel it as a whole. Just now it looks so difficult. How are we going to locate an intellectual? It seems so far away, everything. Right? But as we practice, as it comes in our heart, we will see it through a different light. So don't worry about it. Every student, when he goes to his teacher, he has the same feeling. He cannot comprehend what is going on over there. Now the most important thing for us, most important, is purification of the emotional center. See, Arjun won the hand of Draupadi in the Swayamvar, right? And then Draupadi married the five Pandavas. It's a beautiful story what Draupadi was in her previous life. I hope in this month we can go into that story. It's a beautiful story. Now, just see the story. He is the person who won her hand and they bring her back. She's married to the five brothers. They were in Vanvas in the forest, and from that Vanvas, as Brahmins, they reach Draupadi's Swayamvar. And Arjun wins her hand, not as Arjun, as a Brahmin. And then it becomes apparent that this is Arjun. So they go back to Dhritarashtra, and Dhritarashtra gives them a piece of the kingdom called Khandavprastha. From Khandavprastha, Khandav means khandit, broken down, fragmented. Something, when an old home, nobody is living over there, everything has fallen apart, we call it khandit thayuch. It is, it's now not, it's not possible to live over there. So they were given this land called Khandavprastha. And from that they transformed it into Indraprastha. Indra means the indriyas, the five sense organs, right? The enjoyment of life from the five sense organs. From that which was Khandavprastha, they made Indraprastha. And when they went to live there, the story goes that when one of the brothers is with the wife Draupadi, the other cannot interfere. And when Yudhishthira and Draupadi were together, Arjun had to go into the room to get his bows and arrows to help someone. And so he had to go on a 12-year pilgrimage. He was the person who had won Draupadi's hand, but he could not live with us. You see the metaphors, the hidden truth in the Mahabharata, the hidden truth. He had won her hand, but till the emotional center is purified. So he went on another vanvas for 12 years, where he had so many experiences, where there was inner cleansing. Inner cleansing, right? So the most important part of our sadhana, our inner journey, is cleansing the emotional center, the negative part of the emotional center. This is a 12-year vanvas. Just try to see that, are we feeding the negative side of the emotional center? Someone comes to my home whom I don't like at all. Now he's there. And of course I have to offer him tea, and there is this strong feeling of dislike. Now when I'm observing inside, can I see I'm making the, by that remaining in that strong feeling of dislike, I have to dislike, not him. Try to understand this, that I am living dislike at this moment. I say he is the cause, but he's not the cause, he's just the instrumental cause. Right? I am living, so my negative part of my emotional center, I am making it stronger. I am feeding it. Right? So I have to take in that impression which is coming from him that I don't like this person, I have to make an effort that I don't want that impression to go in and feed the negative part of the emotional center, because my very aim is to be free of that part, to cut it off completely, to kill it, to be free of that part. And in this very disliking of him, I am making that part stronger. So, to take in an impression more consciously, don't allow it to feed the negative part. And this negative part, it seeks food from everywhere. It seeks food from everywhere. People are talking about one person. We love to talk about scandal. And we are talking about one person, maybe he's having multiple affairs or I don't know what. Right? And we love to talk about scandals. And the negative part of the emotional center comes out. I also know one secret of his which nobody else knows. I also know. And we don't realize that we are feeding the negative part of the emotional center. This enjoyment of scandal. And as we feed it, it keeps on collecting material. And this is all inflammable material. It can burst at any time. Somebody in office has just done one small mistake, but it can just burst upon him. Because so much of inflammable material we have collected. And we store it up all over there. And the working of our imagination, we keep on feeding this negative imagination. We keep on feeding this negative part of the emotional center. Have you seen this negative? The sun is just relaxing for some time. Okay. Have you done your homework? Okay. And if you don't do your homework, then the negative imagination will start. Then you will fail in the exam. Mm. And if you fail in the exam, you will do nothing in life. Then you will not earn money. You will not get a proper girl. You will not. Can you see how we are feeding the negative part of the emotional center? Each moment. All negative imagination. So this negative part of the emotional center, we'll take one lecture just on negative emotions. What are negative emotions? Right? I just wanted to finish this sutra. Tada drashtuhu swarupe avasthanam yoga chitta vritti nirodha. If that reactive tendency of the mind, chitta vritti nirodha, can be nirodha stopped. If that reactive tendency of the mind can be stopped, then the seer is in his own state, tada drashtuhu swarupe avasthanam. That inner seer, which is consciousness, which is God, is reflected in that calm waters of the mind. But first the mind has to be freed of its reactive tendency. And that is the journey which we are moving on. Anyway, I'll stop over here. Thank you. Jai Shri Krishna. Good night.